Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Memoirs of an Invisible Child by Kelly Walk Hines. Narrated by Coleen Marlo. Disclaimer. This book is about my life as I recall it as a child. My intentions are not to hurt others by sharing my story. It is my story as I lived and survived it. I have changed the names or left the name out completely to hide identities. Some of the characteristics of the person, town, or any other things that may identify the person have been changed. The names are not important. What is important are the victims and sharing my story so that maybe someone else doesn't have a similar tragedy. Anything I write in this book are things that I have learned from life experience. Nothing I write is to be substituted for professional counseling and physician's advice. These are things that helped me, and I cannot guarantee it will help you. Why I chose to write this book. The Webster Dictionary definition for invisible: not visible, not capable of being seen, not in sight, concealed, not publicly or openly acknowledged. The word invisible means different things to different people. This book is my attempt to explain what it means to me. The things I'm going to share with you are not always about violence toward me directly, but how being immersed in it growing up can affect a person. I want to show how violence against someone you love breaks your heart, to explain how the daily threat keeps you captive in your own fear. This book is my personal story about how the abuse in my life helped turn me into an invisible child. At the young age of 3, while I was at school, my mother was murdered by her abusive new boyfriend. What would happen to 5 unintentionally abandoned children? The heartbreak of the devastating loss of my mother was just the beginning of a series of tragic events that shaped my childhood. Lost in the chaos of abuse, I was the unseen collateral damage of domestic violence. I was forced to take on the role of the invisible child for self-preservation. I figured you couldn't hurt what you can't see. Despite all the sadness in this book, my story has a happy ending. Overcoming obstacles that were meant to destroy me taught me many powerful lessons about strength, resilience, and faith. I want to show you that no matter how dark your world seems, there is a light shining right outside the door. You just need to have faith and keep moving forward, step by step, until you find your peace. Trust me, no matter where your story lies, you can find happiness. I am writing to all the innocent bystanders and to the children who are caught in the middle of the abuse. For these children, I offer hope. The violence may have stolen your childhood, but it doesn't have to steal your future. This book is written for the families of the victims who are forced to remain on the outside. I want to show how the abuser uses fear and manipulation to keep the families apart. My advice to you is not to blame yourself. You cannot control the abuser. I would strongly urge you to never give up on the abused person, no matter how hard it seems. All you can do is pray and hold your hand out until that person is able to reach for it. For the person in the center of the abuse, you are strong. You have control, even though it seems like you don't. I know it seems like things are out of control, but I promise, with small steps, you can regain control. You have the power, although you may not realize it. There are safe places to go. There are people who are waiting to help you. You and your children, if you have them, are worth it. The first step is the hardest, but it's the first step to a new freedom for you and your family. This is a clear warning to the person who causes the abuse. You are causing harm to your children even if you aren't hitting them. Your relationship with them will be forever scarred. The fear and heartbreak that happens over and over can severely scar a child. You may have convinced yourself that no one knows about the abuse or that your child doesn't understand. Trust me, they do. For teachers, bus drivers, and anyone who comes into contact with children who exemplify habits such as acting out at school, getting into a lot of fights or trouble, please pay attention. Someone's life may depend on it. Sometimes the abused children are afraid, so they are quiet and try to blend in with their surroundings, so they aren't noticed. These are the kids that may need extra attention. They may need that one adult who can see past their shyness or acting out. They need an adult to instead see the possible reality of a scared, sad, abused little child. Please be that adult. Take the time to notice and to care. The earlier that child finds someone to trust, the better their chances of healing. Trust me when I tell you that the invisible scar hurts just as bad as any visible scar you see. For all involved in an abusive situation, you need to get professional help. It is not a sign of defeat or shame. The strongest people are the ones who seek help. This book is written to bring awareness to the child that is hurting so intensely on the inside. They feel like they are dying on the outside. I want to share my story with you to offer hope. My story begins like many others, a journey about a child, fragile, pure, and innocent with endless possibilities. The possibilities that are affected by many things such as where you were born, who your parents are, where you live, how you were raised, and the circumstances that life throws at you. I will talk about faith and how it can be a huge factor in helping you overcome anything and give you the strength to survive. I often wonder what people do without faith when they hurt, because I survive because I believe. This is a story of how a little girl, full of possibilities, became the invisible child. I want to show you how, through the discovery of faith, that I came out of the shadows to be heard and never be invisible again. I am writing this memoir on how I remember life growing up and my perceptions as a child. This book is not written to feel sorry for myself. This is a book of hope. I have lived through the heartbreaking murder of my mom, then thrust into a world of domestic violence. I have divided the chapters up into two sections to make it easier to understand. The first section of each chapter is my story. The end of the chapter, under the heading, Things I Have Learned, I put things that I learned growing up in violence. When you read this book, you have two choices. One choice is to read the story all the way through and then go back and read the Things I Learned section. The other option is to just read it all the way through. Just know, as you read through some tough things, know that my siblings and I survived. We are all happy adults. Everything we went through made us stronger. Disclaimer: this book is about domestic violence and all that it encompasses. Most of the situations are tough to read, but I felt like it was important to share my story so that those that are hurting can see that there is another side. I want to offer the hope of healing and finding your joy in life. It's a hard road to travel, but once you get through it, life can be beautiful. Chapter 1. When Your Past Haunts You. Late 60s, early 70s. Psalm 119, verse 28, New International Version. My soul is weary with sorrow. Strengthen me according to your word. We stood there, five frightened children lined up side by side like stair steps, sobbing uncontrollably. We were shaking, even in the warmth of the day. The sun, brightly shining, cast our shadows on the earth behind us. At such a young age, how could we have understood the real significance of the casket being lowered into the ground? The shadows of that day forever left us with a dark heaviness in our chest and a deep void that could never be filled. The birds sang in the trees, the butterflies danced in the air, but nothing around us seemed to matter or make sense at that moment. All the murmured words and sad looks from others seemed to blur into the background. Well-intentioned strangers tried to comfort the grieving children. For a moment, the world stood still. At least for us it did. Everyone wondered what would become of five unintentionally abandoned children. My brother, three sisters, and I, counting down from 11 to 3, all having different understandings of the events that would shape our lives forever. I pray that someday my siblings will write their stories as they remember them, their perceptions of that very moment. Each of us has different memories of the day, different recollections of events that led up to the present. One thing for sure, we all carry the same scar. same loss, the same heartache forever. The littlest child, a scrawny brown-haired girl with tear-stained cheeks, is me. I was 3 years and 7 months old when my mother died. I didn't understand that she wasn't coming back no matter how many times I called for her. I cried mostly because everyone else was crying too. I was too young to grasp how my world would forever be changed. When I was sad from then on, my siblings would comfort me as they struggled to console themselves. Memories are a funny thing. No matter how I try, I cannot bring back one memory of my mother or my time living in Florida. Any information I have of that time are just stories I have heard. I cannot remember her at all. I often wonder what her voice sounded like and how her hugs felt. It's so hard to imagine that I have this intense love for someone that I cannot even remember. Her absence was so substantial that it felt like a constant shadow over me, something I would feel every moment of my life. Losing your parent is heartbreaking. It's honestly one of life's toughest challenges. No matter what age, the pain is severe. Young or old, it would have its own set of struggles. Having no memories of my mom hurts profoundly. She couldn't be there through all the stages of my childhood, and that stings. As for my older siblings, they can remember her laugh, her voice, and how she smelled. They tell stories of her keeping them in line and how she taught them to love one another. She was both carefree and hardened from her past. I wonder if they can close their eyes, picture her, and feel her hugs. Remembering her must hurt so much because they know what they have lost. They had a glimpse of it, and now it's gone. The loss of our mother was such a pivotal time in our lives. For you to truly understand what happened, I must go back in time. I need to rewind a few years to show how all the events in my mother's life resulted in this state of confusion, tears, and heartbreak. My mother's story started long before that fateful day. She was moved back and forth between her mom's home and the home of a preacher. Watching her 5 siblings do the same had to create a sense of abandonment, unworthiness, and uncertainty. The first thing you need to know is that her childhood was challenging. Her life was full of turmoil, frustration, and pain caused by the events in her life. The chaotic childhood drew her siblings together, despite being separated, and that gave them strength. She had an unbreakable bond with them, a relationship that I would soon understand with my brother and sisters. Growing up, I am sure she struggled with self-worth, feeling like she didn't quite belong anywhere. Not knowing where she would lay her head probably made her wonder why she wasn't good enough to live with her mother full-time. I am sure the fear of abandonment consumed her, crushed her, and changed her into a loving but insecure person. It was a recipe to create a dangerous opening for someone to prey on that low self-esteem. Abusive partners often attach themselves to these vulnerable people to manipulate and control them. My mom, tall with long dark hair and deep brown eyes, was a beautiful woman. Her smile and beautiful spirit effortlessly captured the attention of anyone she met. She had a deep love, a strong will, and a wildness not many could tame. My mom was looking for love and was ready to settle down. She searched for someone to protect and give her a place she could call home. She met a man and had my oldest brother, Norman. I always loved my brother. To me, he always seemed bigger than life. He was strong and made me feel safe. Everyone called him by his nickname, Butch. Shortly after they parted ways, she met another man that used her self-esteem issues against her. With him, she had my 3 older sisters. Diane was the oldest. She was strong and always watched over me. I was like her baby, she often told me. Hazel was the 2nd daughter born out of this relationship, only 1 year younger than Diane. She was incredibly strong and always tried to protect me. Then, 2 years later, my sister Jane was born. She was spirited and carefree. Unfortunately, a stable relationship was not part of the deal. My mom's boyfriend continued the abuse, the abandonment, the neglect, and finally left her alone with 4 children. She was a single mom who loved her kids. My mother was a smart and strong woman, I have no doubt. I don't blame her for what happens next. She couldn't have known what laid ahead, or she would have changed the future. Things I have learned. Sometimes we see immediately the hurt we cause people, or the hurt people cause us. Sometimes the damage we do, or the damage done to us, is not even recognized at the time. The effects will show up weeks or months later. Some pain is powerful enough to trickle down through the generations. I have always wanted to write a book to tell my story of the heartbreaking events in my life, but not to feel sorry for myself, but to encourage and give hope to all who are hurting. Things were different back when I was a kid. Thankfully, definite positive changes are being made. Those who make and enforce the laws have since cracked down on domestic abuse. Laws have been put in place to protect the victims of these situations. Claims of violence have been taken more seriously. Restraining orders are more readily given and more harshly enforced. However, much still needs to be done to prevent the abuse further. The number of people being abused daily is still way too high. The fight is far from over. There's still plenty of change that needs to happen. There needs to be more education, shelters, and ways to help the abused get free from the abuser. My goal is to show through my experiences how many abusers use the same tricks and vices to gain control of the abused. This story will show my dad, three different women, and one familiar story. It's scary how similar the stories are to each other. Everything we do, everything we touch, things we love or hate, all have an effect on us and everyone around us. Chapter 2. He Was No Prince Charming, 1967 to 1969. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, New International Version. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. My mom was now a single parent raising four young children. Raising a big family was definitely not a task for the weak. She was strong on her own, but yearned to find love and security. By the time my mom met my dad, she was ready to start over. My dad was 6 foot tall and broad-shouldered. He had thick salt and pepper hair and a well-kept black beard. He was handsome in his own right. He was charming but calculating. He knew how to make you feel at ease and share your most intimate thoughts with him. He seemed to have his life under control. His piercing gray eyes, which could be soft and loving, seemed to look into your soul. He made her laugh and seemed fearless. Little did she know that that was only one side of his personality. Those same gray eyes would also turn cold and send a chill down your spine when angry. Like so many abusers, he was careful not to show that side of him. Not just yet. My dad had two very different sides. On the one hand, he was brilliant and very creative. He loved very passionately and cared very deeply. He was a loyal friend. On the other side, his obsessive personality and paranoia made him an angry and very dangerous man. I never knew what exactly happened to make my dad the way he was as an adult. My dad grew up with his parents and his younger brother out in the country. They had nice things, and on paper seemed like he had a good childhood. My grandmom was a woman who loved very deeply, but was very hard at the same time. I did find out that his father was a strict disciplinarian. I never knew my dad's father, as he died before I was born. I understand that the loss of his father as a young adult had to hurt him tremendously. Whether it was an undiagnosed mental health issue or some type of trauma that affected him, I will never know. He never talked about his past. Like most abusers, my dad made my mom fall in love with him by taking care of her, feeding on her insecurities. She thought she was tougher now after being in some rocky relationships. She figured this was different. My dad didn't have to be around my mom long to realize her priorities were her kids. He knew she was overwhelmed. He was always ready to jump to help her with anything. Nothing seemed too big. She fell for him quickly. He told her all the things she wanted to hear, promising to take care of her and her kids. He would do nice things, even offering to help her out financially if needed, and boy was it needed. She was so tired of struggling to feed her kids and keep a roof over their head. My mom would see him get mad at others and fly off the handle in anger. She just thought he was an avenger for justice. She looked past these outbursts and started making excuses for his behavior. When he started telling her that her friends were terrible for her, she didn't notice what he was doing. He made her feel that they didn't care about her. It took a while, but it was slow and calculated. He would say they were fake and selfish, among other things. One by one, he picked them off. Over time, she pushed away her friends. After all, he loved her and was just being protective of her, right? She loved the fact that he looked out for her. It was something she had never experienced before. She had no idea that what she thought was protection was just a way to control her. Once her friends were no longer a problem, he started with her family. Slowly, one by one, he would show her how they were against him. He wanted her to know they were trying to split them up. A couple of times he came close to creating issues with her siblings, but their bond was too strong. He would create fights. He would fight with their spouses, anything he could do to make them angry at each other. My dad didn't like to share my mom, but she didn't see that. She just loved the fact that he loved her so much. She thought he was what she was searching for, a love that made her feel protected and important. She overlooked his quick temper because she thought he was trying to help her. She had no basis for comparison. She thought it was normal. She didn't realize that the love she felt was him taking possession of her. By removing the people in her life, he could do what he wanted with no one to stop him. He would often tell her what was wrong with her was because of how she was raised. He would continuously correct her, and because she felt he was right, she would try to do better. She just wanted to please him. He assured her that no matter what, he loved her even with her massive flaws. He made her believe that she was lucky to have him help her. She thought since he came from an intact family, he knew more than she did. Little did she know, intact doesn't always mean healthy. He changed from yelling at others to starting to lose his temper with her. Each time he was angry, he blamed it on her. By now, she was under his spell. She believed him when he told her it was her fault. If you could pinpoint a time when he started yelling, it was after he started losing control of her. It was soon after he realized that separating her from her family was not going to work. He managed to get my mom mad at her family for short periods of time, but it never lasted. He began to scream more and to lose patience with the kids. My dad knew how to cut her to the bone with his words, breaking her down after he just built her up. Every day, he reminded her that she was nothing without him. His words scared her, but she loved him. She liked having a house and security for her kids. He would not allow her to work. He told her it was because he wanted her home with the kids. The real reason was he wanted complete control of her. He was afraid of her meeting other men and realizing she could be treated better. Also, having a job meant she would have control of her money. He thought then, maybe, she would save money and move out. He liked having the power over the money. He loved having control of everything. She was not allowed to go anywhere without him, even with the kids. He was sure she was trying to meet other men. At that point, the children were 2 through 7, and most were old enough to remember the abuse. My mom tried to protect them, but she couldn't defend herself. She struggled with wondering what she did to make him unhappy and tried to change things to please him. She didn't realize the reason nothing worked because it wasn't her fault. When my dad would yell, he would seem 8 feet tall and his hand was as hard as a bar of steel. He would snap and break things and scream the most horrible, hurtful things. He did not care that her young children were right there, crying and afraid. The pleas of the children just made him angrier. He would insist that she was cheating on him. When she denied it, she would get screamed at and belittled. Any secrets or weaknesses she had revealed to him were used against her to hurt her. My mom kept thinking if she tried harder, maybe that would make him happy, like in the beginning. she held that memory of how safe he made her feel tucked in her heart. He was working to support her and the kids, she reminded herself. She knew it was hard on him, so she was careful not to make him upset. She had dinner on the table when he came back. He often complained that it wasn't what he wanted or as good as his mom's cooking. He rarely ever complimented her anymore. The tension started to build. My dad would become more irritable. She tried to keep the kids quiet and out of his hair. She wanted to protect them, shelter them from him. He was furious when she kept wanting to spend time with her family. He was so afraid they would talk her into leaving him. He shoved her many times in anger, as he was screaming horrible, hurtful words at her. She fell backward and hit the coffee table with her hip. She collapsed to the floor in tears. He quickly grabbed her and hugged her and said he was sorry that she had made him so mad that he snapped. He got her ice and held her. He asked her to think before she spoke, to realize how hard he worked, and he wouldn't ever do it again. Throughout the evening, he kept saying that if she hadn't said what she did, he wouldn't have done it. She believed him because she thought she did say things out of line sometimes. She knew that she should watch what she said because he worked hard. Her past kept whirling in her head, reminding her that she was damaged. He was sorry. She knew he meant it. The next time, he slapped her across the leg and left a giant welt. He was so angry at her for not having dinner ready when he came home. He was furious because he had worked all day. He said he was tired of having to tell her to have it done when he got back. He would yell at the kids. He didn't care if they were home or not when he raged. He would become frustrated because of the time she spent with her sisters. The hits became more frequent, followed by apologies and explanations why he did it and how she caused him to do it. Her head was spinning, and her heart began to crack. All her insecurities of the past started to resurface with each hit, with each hurtful word. Without her knowledge or consent, he slowly eroded any self-esteem she had. She believed him, that she was wrong, that she caused him to be so angry. She tried to listen to what he said. She tried anything she could to please him. One day he came home so upset she could see the fire in his eyes. He was clenching his fists and talking through his teeth. He was sure she was talking to another guy. She tried to reassure him that she loved him. She told him that she didn't want anyone else, but he didn't believe her. He wanted her to admit that she was talking to someone else and became enraged when she wouldn't. He beat her, screamed at her, and she tried to run out of the house. She was terrified. She was shaking. She had never seen him like this. The hit stung. The words made her chest tight. He wouldn't stop. She had never seen him this angry. She shook. She just wanted to get out. His fists, his words, pounded her. He grabbed her, wrapped her in a cord, and put her in the closet and shut the door. Her mind was racing, her heart pounding out of her chest. She just sobbed until she had no tears left, then became silent. Not understanding how the man she loved could hurt her like this, she cried. She was now quiet, listening for movement, for noise. Suddenly, she heard a woman's voice angrily asking where she was. He said she wasn't there, but the woman was persistent. She recognized the woman to be her sister. She called out to her and heard her run to the door. The door flung open, and her sister grabbed her and hugged her, untying her from her bonds. Together, they ran out of the house. He was yelling and threatening the whole time. They both jumped in the car and took off. Her sister, familiar with an angry man as she had her own demon she dealt with, understood the urgency. Her children were at school, so at least they missed it this time. But they were there for many of the beatings. They were helpless and afraid. Once she was away from him, the calls started. He began to ride by and beg for her to see him. After all, he was sorry, he explained, very sorry. He lost his mind at the thought of someone else having her, that he loved her so much that she was all he ever wanted. She was feeling confused, so very confused. She didn't know how to overcome the love she felt for him. She felt like she needed him. He made it hard for her to move on. She kept thinking back to the days in the beginning, how amazing he was, how happy they were. She began to think maybe it was a misunderstanding. Perhaps she did do something that made him angry. He assured her that he wouldn't do it again and would forgive her for making him jealous. So, against the advice of her family, she went back. She figured if she tried harder, things would go back to the way they were at the beginning. Things I have learned. Do you ever look back at how you met your partner? Maybe it was a look or a moment of unearned trust. That's why I ask you, no, warn you to be careful who you bring into your life and your children's lives. I have thought so long about what makes people snap like that. A huge reason that people become abusive adults can be traced back to their childhood and mental health issues. Knowledge of such trauma does not give any excuse to abusive behavior. Early intervention is the key to changing destructive behavior. I also think that my dad had an undiagnosed mental illness that was exacerbated by drugs and alcohol. There needs to be more attention brought to mental illness. Truthfully, I don't think my dad would have accepted any help as an adult, as he didn't recognize the flaws in his behavior. However, had my dad been treated as a child, maybe things would have turned out much differently. Mental health issues are as severe as diabetes or asthma. They can be treated if they are recognized and diagnosed. It takes a strong person to admit they have a problem or something is wrong. Treatment can be life-changing. The problem may not ever truly go away, but there are healthy ways to manage it and live a relatively unimpeded life. After so many years of being ignored or mistreated, mental health issues are starting to get more professional attention. But when my dad was growing up, there were almost no resources to help people with these issues. The treatment that was available was faulty, and the other option was just to put the mentally ill away, to be ignored and often mistreated. I wish that I could leave this part out. It's so important to tell, and it's a huge piece of what shaped my childhood. I know that through it all, my dad loved me, but not in a healthy way. That's what is hard about abusers. They are people too. They are sick individuals who need help. Anyone who truly knew my dad, even if they loved him, knows that I am right. It breaks my heart to admit these things because he was my only parent I had when I was growing up. Chapter 3. Divide and Conquer, 1968 to 1969. Psalm 46, verse 1. New International Version. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Since my dad was unable to separate my mom from her siblings, he had another plan. He decided that he would move her to Indiana, away from everyone. He pitched it in the way that she couldn't refuse the offer. He would have a better job and be less stressed due to having more money. He said that things had been so tense because he was working so hard for her. She wanted to believe him. She needed to believe him. She packed what she had and grabbed the kids. They said teary goodbyes to her family, and off they went. He thought for sure he would have her under his control in a state so far away from her family. Any freedom she thought she had was gone. He was in control of everything. He was calm for a little while. He had let them settle in their new home. She started to feel comfortable. Soon he became jealous if she went to the store or talked to the neighbor. Hiding her bruises became an everyday task. She was exhausted and hurting. My mom couldn't understand why he wouldn't go back to the man she loved. There's one thing she didn't realize. That man never truly existed. He only had put on a sweet facade to trap her. He continued to blame her and remind her that she was damaged. He told her that no one would want her and her four kids but him. She felt helpless for herself and her kids. She could no longer protect them or herself. Things were out of control. The same pattern occurred again and again. My dad would flip out, scream, and hurt her. Then he would yell at the kids, send them to their room, and leave her crying and bruised in a ball on the floor. He didn't care what the kids saw, heard, or felt. He was deaf to their crying for their mom. He would scream through his teeth, his face beet red. His massive body leaned over the little kids as they huddled together. After he would calm down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.